Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear wonderful people, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. One of the most dangerous things a person can do when it comes to Islam is to take a small portion of a hadith or take one hadith out of 100 hadith and then apply them and thinking like this is it. For example, these days when we go to the masjid to perform our salat, Salatul Dhuhr for example, now is taking place in the realm of between 7 to 10 minutes tops. And then every other salat, and if you take your time to perform salat, for example, if you go to Salatul Fajr and the imam stays 15 minutes, people start complaining. And then they will mention the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ or the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ that is mentioned in Al-Bukhari where he says to Mu'ad, Ya Mu'ad, are you a troublemaker? Are you a fattanun anta ya Mu'ad? Are you a troublemaker? Why do you take your time in salat? Shorten the salat for there is the week and things like that. And then they come to you and they say, you see, the sunnah is to actually simplify a salat. Is that really true? Is that what the sunnah is? Now let me tell you the events in which this hadith came and see for yourselves if we can apply it today or not. As reported in Al-Bukhari, it was the norm that as-sahaba radiallahu anhum would sit in the masjid and wait for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to come out for as-salat. They didn't have these 20 minutes and 15 minutes. And do you know how the calculation of these 15 to 20 minutes came? In Al-Bukhari and Muslim and many other books of the Sunnah, the Sahabi said that from the Salat, from the Adhan, till we performed the Salat, it was about reciting 200 ayat. So somebody said someday in our time here and recited 200 ayat, I don't know from where, which part of the Quran, and they topped it and it was about 15 to 20 minutes and then they said this is the sunnah. Well, actually that is not the sunnah. If we really want to know, we want to sit down and recite 200 ayat and see how much of that time. But this is like a side dish information. So you know that today we are doing a lot of the stuff that is not part of the sunnah and Allah is not pleased with us. It really is simple. We're doing tons of things according to our whims and desires. And now, as I said, so I'm gonna tell you where that story of the Mu'ad and shortening the salat came from. So one day it was night and it was Salatul Isha. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum were waiting and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some of them fell asleep, some of them, anyway, they were waiting on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who came at the end of the night, towards like 11 o'clock. And at that time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's Isha was not 10 minutes, 15 minutes. It was about half an hour or something like that. So Mu'adh radiallahu anhu prayed with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So let's say he tops everything he finished at midnight. Mu'adh lived about 5 miles away from the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Al-Madinah. That's where he lived. And he was the imam of his people. So what he would do, radiallahu anhu, he would finish the salat with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because he doesn't want to miss that salat. And then ride his donkey. And then how long will it take you to go for 5 miles? Let's say 45 minutes. Then he would get to the people. So in that particular night, he got to his people. And about, as I said, 12:45 or something of that sort, maybe later or earlier, depending on that time of the day, but it's irrelevant, but he was late. And then he said, Allahu Akbar, and the people were behind him, and they were farmers, and they were all that kind of stuff. And then he started reciting Al-Quran, and you know what he recited in Salatul Isha? Suratul Baqarah. Suratul Baqarah. If you read it as fast as you can, it's a minimum of an hour, 45 minutes. And this is in Salatul Isha alone. There was a young man in the congregation in the masjid and he was extremely tired. He patient, but Mu'adh wouldn't stop. So what the young man did, he quit in a salat. And this is a ruling for us also to learn from. So if one day you are in a salat and the imam is taking long time and you need as an emergency to pull, you can pull intentionally. This young man left a salat because he was extremely tired and he left home. At that time, people know each other. So they turned only to see that this young man was not there. And they said he is a hypocrite. How could he leave as the imam was giving the salat al-Baqarah? So at that moment there, Salatul Baqarah, Salatul Isha on that particular day took over 2 hours. The following day, the young man was absolutely upset with the doing of Mu'adh and what the other people had said, that he was a hypocrite. So he went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and complained to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah became extremely angry and called Mu'adh. He was so angry and he told him, Ya Mu'adh, afattanun anta ya Mu'adh? Are you a troublemaker? Are you repulsing people from the religion of Allah? And then he said to him, Where are you from? والشمس وضحاها والليل إذا يغشى. Where are you from this? And then he told him, when you do your salat, pay attention to the people. There are people that are busy, that have things like that. Okay, Mu'adh radiallahu anhu learned his lesson, and now he prays with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when he goes to his people that are waiting for him very late, he would pray short salat. This is the whole story. But now, alhamdulillah, you know the whole thing, and I am sure you didn't know this. So now, how do we apply it today? People take that portion, the end of what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Mu'adh radiallahu anhu. Yeah, Mu'adh, are you a troublemaker? Shorten the salat. Now, anytime Salatul Fajr, subhanallah, is 7 minutes now. But this is crazy. Salatul Dhuhr, 7 minutes. We do forget something. What Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Mu'adh is the sunnah to apply if you are in the condition and the circumstance of Mu'adh. If the people that you work with are laborers and they are mashallah every salat in the masjid and they are pious and you know they recite Al-Quran and you know this, and then when it's late night in summer, if you pray Salat al-Isha at 11 o'clock and Fajr is at 2 o'clock, we have a gap of 3 hours. Now, if you take 45 minutes in the Salat al-Isha, that is too much for us. However, if in winter like this, Salat al-Isha is 5 p.m. and Salat al-Fajr is at 8 a.m. So we have kind of like a whole stadium of time where we can fit our lives. Well, if you take time to pray Salat al-Isha half an hour, it would not declare the Third World War. But we Muslims today, we have become very selective. For example, another example. In the authentic hadith, people say, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Man qala la ilaha illallah, dakhala al-jannah. Whoever says la ilaha illallah, enters Jannah. Today, we have this sort of Muslims. Every time you talk to them, they say, Allah is ghafoor rahim. Allah forgives. Allah has got mercy. Allah this and Allah that. Now, when I look at this one here, the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man qala la ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah, whoever says la ilaha illallah enters al-jannah." That's it. Now I will not do my salat, I will not do my zakat, I will mess around my salat, I don't learn my Islam and I don't know what I'm saying, and I keep disobeying Allah and I just keep saying la ilaha illallah and enter al-jannah. But what these people don't tell you is there are tons of other ahadith which have been mentioned on the conditions of la ilaha illallah. For example, you have to submit to la ilaha illallah in everything that you do in your life, from the time you wake up in the morning until the time you go back to bed. That's it. This is la ilaha illallah. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Say, my salat and when I slaughter my animals and my living and my death are all for Allah. This is la ilaha illallah. Meaning, throughout the day, when there is a choice of you obeying Allah or obeying a shaitan, you must ally with Allah at any one point. If someone backbites to you and you listen to them, you both of you are in the group of a shaitan. So here, what I do, I should not take one hadith out of a whole context. And I'll give you an example. For example, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man salla lillahi 12 rak'ah, bana Allahu lahu baytan fil jannah." And this hadith is authentic in Bukhari Muslim. Whoever prays to Allah 12 rak'ah a day, Allah builds a house for him in Jannah. And this hadith is authentic, Bukhari and Muslim, and in the Abu Dawud, and it's authentic hadith. What this means, Ya Rasulullah, and this is what we call the sunnahs, the two of the Fajr, the four before Dhuhr, the two after Dhuhr, that makes it 8, the two after Maghrib, that makes it 10, and the two after Isha, that makes 12. So if you keep doing this every single day, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will build a house for you in Al-Jannah. Now, someone will come to you and says, okay, this hadith here mentions only 12. It doesn't mention Fajr, It doesn't mention Dhuhr, it doesn't mention Isha, it doesn't mention Asr, it doesn't mention Maghrib. It only mentions 12 rak'ah. And guess what? I will only pray the 12 rak'ah, but I will not pray any other salat. And believe me, there are people who do that. So why? Because they said, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if you pray 12 rak'ah, Allah builds a house for you in Jannah. Now I ask you a question. Do you think that is going to happen? And I'm sure you'd say no, because if you say yes, that is a big problem. So as you can see here, if I truncate one hadith from a whole context, let's say I get lost. Women, when it comes to the hijab, they take a portion of the hadith, the covering of the head, and that becomes the hijab. Absolutely wrong. The hijab is the guard, i.e. it's a garment that you wear that covers the entire body. For the external world there, you are wearing a hijab and it protects your body and everything. Underneath the hijab, you can wear a miniskirt for all it cares, as long as nobody can see it in the outer part of the hijab. And many other. So how is Islam today being hijacked? It's being hijacked by some ideologies. And Allah is Ghafur Rahim, it means he will go to Jannah. You're really crazy. So all the ahadith and all the Quran that speak about the quality of your Islam, we will dump them just because of one quantity of your act. As I said before, my brothers and my sister and you wonderful souls out there, Al-Islam is a comprehensive religion. Today it's been hijacked. Each one uses it for an agenda. Each one uses it. And I'll tell you something that's gonna blow your mind away. How come the people that didn't have the ahadith documented were performing very well in Islam, and today we have everything that is documented and we suck big deal when it comes to Islam? Islam calls for unity, we are totally disunited. Islam calls for considerations, we are totally inconsiderate. Islam calls for mutual help, we're totally unhelpful. Islam calls for the beauty of this world to be worked on, enjoyed and shared, we totally are completely egocentric. Islam has brought a rahmah, mercy on earth, and we Muslims are full of hatred. Watch. Back in time, when Muslims have the ability to express themselves, what do? They resort to what? Suicide bombing, killing, hurting. And don't think that it is only in Syria or Iraq. Now, back in the late of the 80s or maybe mid 90s, Algeria went through that, and Muslims killed each other over 100,000 people. Muslims died. Killed by whom? By Muslims. Tunisia now comes what? Muslims are killing each other. Libya, Muslims killing each other. Egypt, I pray to Allah to safeguard Egypt. Brothers, what's wrong with us? Muslims today, we are monsters. We just don't have the possibility to apply that monstrosity. Look, when you see a lot of people, for example, I'll take Libya, for example, for this example, or for that matter, Syria, or any place where they're killing, in Yemen, Egypt, everything. When Muslims are under the boots of oppression, and you see them in the masjid, they all are beautiful souls, like you see them, calm, nothing. But as soon as the opportunity comes to express themselves, they resort to the killing. Subhanallah, somebody puts bombs on themselves and go to some place where Muslims are and explode themselves. What for? What kind of brainwashing that they had to actually kill Muslims and expect to go to Jannah? Subhanallah, what's wrong with us? Is this how Islam came? Is this what Islam came for? That when we Muslims get the opportunity, our life becomes miserable? This is why the West doesn't want Muslims to have nothing to do with Islam. I'll tell you something that I personally have lived. In the early 90s, here in England, there was some deviated party, Muslim party. They were political and they thought they were the biggest activists and things like that. Wallahi al-Azim, I swear, I saw it with my own eyes and I dealt with their leaders and we used to have debates because they were promoting some evil Islam. One day they printed thousands upon thousands upon thousands of stickers. The sticker's color was black. And the writing was white, and they were stuck all over town. Do you know what it says that? Islam is coming to rule Britain with the Sharia. Islam is coming to rule Britain with the Islamic law. What kind of understanding coming here to Europe and tell them that Islam is going to rule you, go on YouTube. See how these people in the 90s used to talk. One of them, he was chased in his own country. When he came here, what he told them, he said, England is like a bathroom to us. It's like a toilet. We go there to fulfill our needs. And he goes, we are here to fulfill our needs, and one day we will rule England. And people didn't say much. And little did I know that the world was working to put this person. Then they took him to the first opportunity. He was a British citizenship. Do you know what they did? They took away the citizenship away from him in a very diplomatic way. He went to Lebanon, and then some calamities happened there. A war, something broke out there. When he wanted to come back, they actually stopped him from even boarding. They think now he is not allowed at all. No British citizenship, nothing at all. Is this what Islam is all about? That we hate the worst, but they give us houses and they take care of us, freedom of expression, and alhamdulillah, we are safe. And my sisters, you walk with the hijab now today, and the brother is there and things like that. But we have double personality. A lot of Muslims that live in England here have a double personality. The kuffar, the this and this and this. We don't even acknowledge the goodness of what Allah has given us. And this is why the West doesn't trust us. It doesn't trust us because we are a bunch of let the opportunity come and I will become a vampire, I will become a Dracula, and I will suck your blood away. Murders happening here. So my brothers and my sisters, please, for the love of Allah, watch out. Don't truncate any text from the context. And certainly do not, and I will say this with every single cell in my body, never ever believe anyone that tells you hurt and Allah will be pleased with you. I repeat, never ever believe someone that tells you hurt another human and Allah will love you and will get into Jannah. Never do that. This is not what Islam came for. And I am not saying this because I am in England or scared. It's not that. But this is our Islam. This is the beauty of our Islam. The Sahaba never ever of them hurt any people, and there were plenty Jews, and there were plenty atheists, and there were plenty mushriks in their time, and they mingled a lot with people. So my brothers and my sisters, for the love of Allah, when someone incites you to minimize Islam, either to shorten the salat, or play with the texts, or hurt people, or disfigure Islam, or have dysfunctional acts of worships, come back to your senses and double check the information. And the best way to do that is learn Arabic. And hang on to this group here, because I will deliver to you, as I said before, an Islam as pure as that of the Prophet ﷺ. No agendas, no politics, no culture, and no this and no that. When I do my researches, I don't pinpoint to Saudi Arabia only. Saudi Arabia to me is anything else, just like Egypt, like anybody else. Islam is not Saudi Arabia. There is a difference between living Islam as Allah wants it and living a filtered Islam. And filtered Islam is causing us headaches, tons of problems. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our eyes, our hearts, and our actions, and make us the people, innama bu'ithtum muyassirin. You are sent out to mankind as facilitators, not as hard makers, like you make things hard for people. This is again your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa, and my telephone number here in the United Kingdom is 078-76-40-8735. For the love of Allah, promote and share these pep talks and let the world discover the beauty of Islam. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.